Wednesday evening, August the 9th, in the year of our Lord 2023. Welcome to all of you to another broadcast of Livestream Interact, where we interact with you on all sorts of subjects. Thank you very much again for tuning in. We are here, as Jeffrey would call it, home alone, Jeffrey and I. And you're going to get a surprise again tonight from Jeffrey. You're going to see him in another angle, another position on the screen. We wanted you to stay tuned with us here. We're going to be talking about any and everything and whatever you want to interact with us on, whatever subject matter that you would want to bring up. Please do so. It is your program for you to interact, for you to share with us, for you to give your comments, to make your statements, for you to speak to the leaders of St. Maarten and tell us what you're not happy with, or what you're happy with, and so on. We want to welcome you from all around the world. We want to welcome you from the Europe area, the Netherlands, Great Britain, Spain, France, Italy, all of those countries where we have friends and well-wishers, and those who always view us on live stream. We want to welcome you as well from the United States of America, USA, New York City, Brooklyn, Boston, Texas, LA, Florida. We want to welcome you from the Bahamas area. We go back into South America, probably Venezuela. We have some friends also in Peru and Panama and what have you. We want to welcome you as well from the Caribbean region. Let's go right down into Trinidad and Tobago, as we always will like to mention Trinidad and Tobago, Barbados, Dominica, which is the Commonwealth of St. Kitts and Nevis, the Commonwealth of Dominica and the Federation of St. Kitts and Nevis. Let me make that very clear. And we want to also welcome you who are viewing us from Curacao, Aruba and Bonaire down south. We want to also welcome all of you who are viewing us from the SSS Islands, not including St. Maarten, but Saba and St. Eustatius. We already mentioned St. Kitts and Nevis. We're going to welcome you also from St. Bart's, Anguilla, even the southern part of St. Maarten, French St. Martin, as well as our brothers and sisters over there. We want to get into some other subject, but before I get into that, let me just welcome all of you who are visiting us, are viewing us then from the Dutch side of St. Maarten, or wherever you're viewing us. Welcome to another broadcast live stream of Inter. I want to say welcome to our host as well, Jeff Richardson, and I would like ask for him to say a few words to all of you before we really get into the topic. I know he has a lot of stuff to talk to you about. We want to just get into a few matters that are of concern to us before we speak about any and every subject that we're going to talk to you about. Welcome, Jeffrey.
Welcome, Roberto. Thank you for welcoming me, actually. Today, I would like to convey what Mr. Raphael Skeet has just wrote as a text on our live stream. He says, please let the family of Roberto Arundel know that they are all in our prayers, and I'm sure that all of us have the family in our prayers as well. You know, today is a very, I would say, a very sad day again for St. Maarten. It's a day when we are challenged again with a situation with one of our icons, one of our legends that we have just lost today again. I know it's going to be a very tough time for all of St. Maarten, because this person, and none other than Roberto Arundel, was a person that was very known here in St. Maarten. He did a lot for this country. He was a school teacher, Roberto. And there's a lot of young people that knows Roberto extremely well. Just today I was talking to a friend of mine. They were talking about the fact that when he comes back from the Dominican Republic, he was going to pass by them to be able to give them some information and to give them some, you know, some whitening with regards to
We're talking about
the school education.
About the students.
He was going to come by the students and was going to give them some ideas on how they should be able to, you know, to go about their tests, etc.
Maths and stuff like that.
Well, whatever subject that he was going to give them, you know. So it's a very tough time for the entire St. Martin, and especially for the family, his wife and his kids, you know. It's going to be very tough for them as well. But Roberto, this is life. God has everything in his hands. God knows the reason why this has happened. And we make sure that we say, hey, it's all about him. God knows the reason why it happened the way it happened. And we must continue with life. You know, so I want to just, you know, say to all of you, let us continue to live close to each other to make sure that we are one. And that whatever we do things to be able to help and each other and to make each other better people.
You know, Jeffrey, this weekend, and I want to just say thank you very much to Raphael. You know, actually, we were about to talk about that, to mention that, because in particular this week, more than probably any other week, because we have been losing a lot of our people in St. Martin over the past year or years, that it is so noticeable. I've gotten some information, statistics on the amount of the volumes of people that are passing, in the sense of that it is giving an indication that something is happening, not just in St. Martin, but all around the world, in terms of let's say, the volumes of persons passing is on the increase, and because of whatever is happening, whether it is COVID-19 or what have you. But particularly this weekend, I spoke to Jeffrey about that just today, and I said, look at that. You know, we didn't have this week planned like this, and we never know what the next day brings us. We didn't know that we were going to have the homegoing service of our neighbor and our sister, Blondell Warner, on Tuesday. We didn't know that that we will be dealing with today, Wednesday, the homegoing service of Renee Roland as well. Our dear friend Renee, you know, we grew up with him and his mom and the rest of the family. We didn't know that we were going to have the homegoing, that he was going to pass during this time, that today would be his homegoing funeral service on the friend side. And tomorrow there is going to be the homegoing of our dear friend. I think this is an elderly
Calvin Marlboro's.
I think it's his mom. We want to give our condolences to him and the rest of the family.
Benedict's mom,
you know, the rest of the family over the bank. Henry, Marciella Henry as well, and all of those. All of the families and residents of Over the Bank, we want to give you our sincere condolences with the loss, I would say, of a legend, an icon, as we would always say it. Our prayers are with you. Again, it doesn't stop here, because from time to time, we will be losing someone. The same way that, you know, the Lord brings someone, a child into the world, we always lose people that go home to be with the Lord as well. So it's just a reality that we have to live with. And because St. Martin is a small community and everyone knows everyone, Jeffrey, it hits us very deep, because, you know, it's either your family or friends, or it's your neighbor, it's someone that you know very well from school, or it can be your teacher in this case, with Celestino Arundel, you know, not just an educator, but he's a playwright, you know. He's done poet. A lot of, he's a poet. He's very talented in so many different areas.
He was a politician
areas.
As well.
Exactly, he was a politician as well. So many different areas, so many shoes and so many caps he filled, you know. And we want to just, you know, shout out to his family, his immediate family, especially his children and his wife, because they were a close-knit family, Jeffrey. You know, we can imagine what the family is going through right now, the pain, the depth of the pain right now, the fact that, you know, Roberto has, you know, he has left us, you know, so suddenly, you know, and we just want to just let the family know that our prayers are with you. We will keep on praying for you. The whole of St. Maarten is standing with you as a family. So rest assured that God is in total control of this. And the pain and the sorrow will soon become great memories after time. So what I would want to just say to all of you, and in this case also to the family of Roberto, the late Roberto Celestino Arundel, is to, you have to just take this journey every day, one step at a time. Jeffrey?
Yeah, Roberto, I agree with that. They're going to have to take it one step at a time. That is a way that all of us have to take our loved ones when they pass on, you know, because this is nothing new to nobody. This is something that all of us is going to go through. We're going to experience this. But we want to make sure, let them know that the people of St. Maarten are with them. And I know that in the beginning it's going to be very, very difficult, like you said. But as time goes by, we're going to be able to deal with it. We're going to be able to deal with the memories that we have of him, especially the good memories that we have had with Roberto Celestino Arundel. I remember speaking to him a couple months ago, and I asked him, I said, I would love to have you on a program, you know, with us, on Interact program. And he said, it's not a problem. He will definitely be ready to go on that, on a program as such. You know, but when I heard that he passed on, it really touched my heart very, very much, because, you know, at times you want to ask persons to go on, or you ask them to go on, and then time goes by, and then you didn't really push it very hard. And then you hear after that person passed away. For example, a person like Joe Fasol, Joseph Richardson. I remembered him too. I really wanted him.
He celebrated his birthday
on the program.
Yeah,
I really wanted him on the program as well. And we was not able to get him on the program, but he passed on before the time. You know, and others as well. And the good thing about the some other persons, we were able to get them on programs, and they passed on after a while, like person like Diedrich Canegito and Mr. Hazel, Cyril Hazel. I think we have one or two others as well,
yes,
that passed on.
Reno Groeneveld.
Mr. Reno Groeneveld. You know, those persons were persons that we got an opportunity to speak to them about their life and whatever they wanted to see happen and their legacy, etc. So we were happy to have them on. We are now able to go and, you know, go through whatever we discussed with them, and you can do the same thing too, because all of those programs are archived. And somebody was telling me, why not have government, you know, get those programs on as a video and in their museum. And I think that's a very good idea. I think also our good friend Blayden, Alfonso Blayden, was one of them.
Exactly.
Also, that
that's
we
right,
had,
the icon.
We were able to have an interview with him as well. You know, so all those persons that have passed on and that they are still here, we should be able to get them on a pro, whether it's a museum or whatever, to get them so persons will be able to see what kind of person they were and how they were able to, you know, to be a part of contributing to our country, St. Maarten.
You see, One of the things we got to get into what we're doing here today, because Jeffrey's on the other, on the same side of the screen with myself, you know. But one of the things that, you know, with that really is important about all this, you know, and we, you know, we do this with passion. We do this with seriousness, because it's not just to give information about, you know, a particular topic or a particular issue, whether it is in the private sector or whether it is in the community, whether it's something cultural or educational, or whether it's something political or whether it's what. But, you know, one of the things we want to educate our young people of St. Maarten is that, you know, your role models, your heroes have been living amongst you, or they are even still living among you. Those heroes or those role models are your dads, your moms, your uncle, your aunt, your teachers, your pastor, some leader in government, or what have you. So many different areas. They're right here among us. And what we do, Jeffrey and I do with this program too, is they can be legendary sports players, just like Raffles Kid. We just had him on a minute ago. And what we do is we try to bring them back into recognition, because a lot of our young people they've heard of them or may not have heard of them, because there's no one that is sharing this information with them. So we want them to know that, you know, you have your own heroes, you have your own icons, you have your own legends living right here in St. Maarten. And it doesn't matter where they come from, you know. There are so many names that we can mention, and probably one of these days we're going to go into that. But even before going in depth into the subject matters of this evening, Jeffrey, because we are home alone, I just want you, for the sake of the viewers, you know, you always go on screen and just tell us who's on, who are viewing us tonight. So give the...
Yeah, before I do that, I want to mention, it just came to my mind, I want to mention, and that's why it's important not to have a look at time and believe you always have time to do things. Whenever you think that you want to do something, you just do it. It doesn't matter what people Absolutely. Think about it, just do it. I remember going to the home of Mr. Arnold Brown. I never forget that. That will always live on in my mind. I went to his home to see if I could have gotten him to come on the program. And when I went there, his daughter told me, "Jeffrey, my father is sick. He's not doing so well." I said, "What?"
Wow.
I couldn't believe that. So I went, because it was a long time I wasn't seeing him, you know, moving around, you know, outside and stuff that, where he lives. So I told him, I asked her, "Can I see him?" She said, "Of course." She brought him inside with me. When I went in, I saw him. It really touched my heart, seeing him in his bed and not being able to respond, and I was able to pray with him and stuff like that, you know, and he wasn't responding to me. And the following day, I spoke to his daughter. His daughter told me, you know, they just picked him up and they took him to the hospital, and the day after that, he passed on.
Wow.
You know, that was very tough for me. It was a very hard time, because it was like, how am I going to deal with this situation, knowing that I wanted to get him on a program, but was not able to do that because I was just a minute too late to make sure that he was on one of our programs. Because these programs that we have on, you can always go back to them and you can go through them and see what the person is saying, the contribution the person made to this country, etc. To see what kind of legend that person was, the kind of hero that person was. You can always go back and go through whatever they said and whatever interview we had with them. So I said to myself, no. I'm going to start going by people and making sure, let them know that I want to have them on Interact.
Yeah.
And as soon as possible. Just today I was passing down Backstreet, and you know what I saw? I saw Gums, James Gums' father, Tony Gums' father. What's his name? Who had that little place there on Backstreet?
Joe.
Joe. I saw Joe Gum. I said, Joe Gum, how are you doing?
Famous
Joe Gum said, okay. Joe. He didn't know what it was, so I told him, it's Eki's son. He said, oh, okay, good. I said, I got a pad by you to see one of these days because I think Joe's someplace in his 90s, I believe.
Probably.
Yeah, so I would love to have him come on the program because if you know, Joe still does his own shopping.
Of course.
I saw him a couple times in the shops doing his own shopping. So, you know, he's able to still, you know, speak to the people of St. Maarten and let them know, you know, exactly what he's doing and what he's all about and how he has contributed to this country, St. Maarten. You know, so I spoke to him and maybe sometime this week I'm going to go back to him and see when we can, you know, get him to go on the program.
And you know why you're saying that, Jeffrey, anyway, on this topic is just having us go in all directions.
Yeah, you said you wanted me to,
yeah,
to say
yeah,
who's
yeah,
on the program.
Yes, yes,
let me
yes.
give
jump,
you
jump into that because
yeah, let me jump right into the person that are on the program. We have Edorna, oh, she's a regular viewer. Wendell Phillips, a regular viewer. Andrew Williams.
Andrew, that's our cousin Andrew.
Marshall Richardson, Ramona Thomas also.
Ramona,
a regular viewer. Rafael Skeet. Rafael Skeet always on. And Mary Fermis, always on this program. You know, so I want to thank all of you who have come on this program to be a part of this program. And hope that you will continue to be a part of this program, Roberto. Also, I want to let the folks that are viewing know that on October 7th, we're having a special program where we're going to have persons that are going to come to the Bel Air Community Center to be able to see the program live. We're going to have some special persons that are going to be on the program. We're going to say it sometime in the next couple weeks. We're going to mention who the guest is going to be. And then you will know exactly who those persons would be for that particular time. But we will have a live stream program, but with persons that will be our audience at the Bel Air Community Center.
Now, I was going to force you, Jeffrey, to just, you know, get the cat out of the bag. You don't have to keep saying, you know, we're going to have a special guest, but probably you can just say to the live stream viewers out there who are going to be our special guests, you know. Because that is what we intend to they who are who we intend to have. It is the 7th of October, a few days before 10-10-10. So I want you to just go into that basically and just say who are going to be our guests.
What we're going to have that day is going to be a very special day because it's going to be a pre-constitutional day commemoration. And we have asked persons that were the prime ministers of this country. I've already sent invitations to them. There's one person that might not be there, that would not be there because of medical situation, which is going to be Prime Minister William Martin. But the other prime minister, so from 2010 to 2014, Prime Minister Sir Westcott Williams, 2014 to 2016, Prime Minister Marshall Gumbs. And then 16 to 18 is Prime Minister William Martin, who's not going to be there. Then 2018 to 2019 is going to be Prime Minister yeah. Leona Romeo. And then from 19 up to now is going to be Prime Minister Sylvia Jacobs.
Great.
Those are the persons that are going to be on for that day. And they're going to be talking about their time that they had, their period that they had as Prime Minister during our 2010 to 2023 separate status.
Yes, yeah, so there you go. Jeffrey gave you an indication on that. And I want to also welcome all of you, all of those of you that Jeffrey mentioned. Thank you very much for coming on. And we want to just kind of shift a bit into some areas that that are important to us, important to the people of St. Maarten for your knowledge, for your information. But I just want to go back and say that it is not just the senior folks, the icons, or the legends, those who are passing away, those who are up in age. But we have icons, young people who are icons, Jeffrey. We have legendary sports players, those who are in the music and the arts. And, you know, a lot of things that, you know, that I don't want to talk about that, but by things that we, you know, the Democratic Party are talking about in terms of how we are bringing out our platform for this election campaign. But that is not the specific for this or the topic for tonight. But I just wanted to go into something that's very important too, because sometimes people are not well informed about let's say even government and how government runs in some ways. But I want to specifically talk about something that a lot of you may not be aware of, or do you not understand how it works, and it has to do with simple business licenses, or what you call, what we call in Dutch, a vestigingsvergunning. So a business license for you to operate or run a business. There are all sorts of business licenses. Anyone can obtain a business license, but there are categories, and I'm going to say very, very short on this topic, but there are categories of business licenses that needs an operational permit, what we call an exploitation license, or in Dutch an exploitatievergunning. And these exploitation permits are only issued based on certain conditions, and that I don't want to really get into. So what I want to say to the people out there is that not necessarily a business license gives you the authority or the permission, as Jeffrey says, to operate. You can get a business license for a club where music is being played, but you also need an operational license for the club because of the noise and all that. You can get a business license for a gas station, but you need an operational license because government has to approve based on certain specific conditions where the gas station will be located, because specific conditions where the gas station cannot be located in the range 200 meters from a church or school, for example. I'm just giving things like that. So I just want to educate the people in Maarten that you going to the notary and getting, let's say, an NV or a BV, and then going from there with the process to getting a business license by the Economic Affairs Department, and to the Chamber of Commerce where you get a chamber registration, does not automatically mean that you are able to operate the business. And it all depends on the type of business that you are requesting. You want to say something, Jeffrey?
Yeah, I'm gonna give you a very good example of what you're trying to say. I remember back in the 90s when I was the director or the managing director of Reggie's Car Rental, and we had a business license, but we still needed an operational license to see how much cars we are going to have as
in the fleet, for example.
Yeah, because they will tell you in the operational license how many cars you would have, because you can't just have any kind of amount of cars that you want. Yes. And the operational license will tell you how many cars you are allowed to have in your fleet,
which is approved then by government.
Which is an operational license, and it's approved by government.
Exactly.
That's
a good example. I use the example of the particular gas station. I use the example of a club.
Yeah.
You can go into all sorts of things. You talk about car rentals. You can talk about hotels. You can talk about also, you know, it's just so things like that. Even today, you know, what has to be seriously taken into consideration, also grocery stores, these small groceries, you know, not having just not only getting a building permit, for example, for a building that you want to transform into, let's say, a grocery store, but you also need to know that that permit for that grocery store is not in a location where there are three or four or five other grocery stores in close proximity. And that is what is causing a lot of problems today in St. Martin. And that is why I said to someone today, I said, there is no way where, as far as government is concerned, where the Ministry of Romy, for example, that issues permits, building permits, cannot work independent to, let's say, the Ministry of TIET that issues business licenses. Because while the building has to be constructed and needs, yes, a building permit, it is a commercial building that also needs a business license, which is issued by the Ministry of TIET, in this case, the Ministry of, or the Department of Economic Affairs. And then, Jeffrey, we just talked about also the operational part of it. Jeffrey, use a few examples. You can use a, you can put in addition to that, let you said car rentals. You can put in that category too, let's say even airline companies, for example. And you know, you can't operate an airline if you don't have an operational license, and the operational license has to go through certain proceed. It has to go through the process of aviation, where a lot of conditions are met. You know, you won't be able to operate an airline company, for example, if you don't have the aircrafts. Mm-hmm. You can't prove that you have the aircrafts, mm-hmm. whether you bought them or you leased them, and there are other conditions that the Department of Aviation mm-hmm. grants, and they have the conditions. I've seen them on paper. So if you have not qualified in that area, a simple business license cannot give you the rights to operate, or the approval or the permission to operate, whether it is an airline company or it's a car rental company or it's a gas station or what have you. You wanted to add something to that, yeah. Jeffrey?
I just wanted to know is if there are people that are operating without an operational license.
In what area?
I don't know which area.
Yeah, they're always... Look, of course there are people sometimes that are operating, and they're operating illegal, Jeffrey. They're operating illegal. And so let's say the supervision or the inspection of that
is not
at the pace of the development of these sorts of businesses. So it behooves the government also to have proper inspection and to shut down these types of businesses that are operating without a permit. In St. Martin's situation, it is so severe, Jeffrey, so serious that it is out of control. And that is why, for example, you see... And I just mentioned the grocery. I don't want to keep picking on the grocery stores, and you know, whether it is a grocery stores run by whomever, but you know, you get the grocery store businesses that is affecting, let's say, those that are existing. Can you imagine? You have a grocery store. It's been in a particular location for 20 years, Jeffrey, mm-hmm. and then another person buys a property next door to you. No one knows that property is going to be developed for a grocery store. And then the building is built, and then the next day you see a grocery store comes in.
But government has to know.
If there is no legislation, Jeffrey, for that, if there is no policy, of course government knows. But if there is no policy, if there is no legislation for that, then what happens is that you get these grocery stores and these shops or whatever keep mushrooming here and there. And when you think that, yes, it is good for economical development, it is killing those businesses that are already there in the past. And things such as this, legislation, establishing policies and stuff like that are things that we are very much concerned about in the future, that this be the order of the day in terms of the new St. Maarten, a St. Maarten that is structured, a St. Maarten that is organized, a St. Maarten that there is a comprehensive development from all avenues and all areas of the St. Maarten's overall development. So there's going to be a programs where we're going to talk more about that area, so we don't want to really, you know, get into the depth with that. But the point we want to make here is that a business license does not give you automatically the permission to operate a business, depending on what type of business it is, that is stipulated by law that needs an operational license or an exploitatievergunning. So, and these are the things that you have to be educated on, because you yourself, you can be fooling yourself into thinking that you can automatically operate when you cannot. And those are the things that, you know, again, if government is not informing you of such, or if they're informing you and you still believe that you can, then it's unfortunate. But those are some of the factors that you need to be aware of, and you need to be informed, and you need to be educated on by way of the government of St. Maarten in this case.
But Roberto, if government is informing you that you cannot operate without the operational license, and you still do so, I think what has to be put in place is a fine.
Of course.
A fine will have to be put in place.
And a heavy fine.
And if you are not putting fines in place for persons who are breaking the rules,
breaking the law,
then I have a big problem with that. A serious problem with that. And you know, one thing you mentioned groceries. And I also want to stick to that, because I want to look at from 88th Road straight over to going to Dutch Quarter area. And I see a lot. I counted so much grocery stores there. And another person that are supporting those groceries are the Simon people.
Yes.
I have realized that. And that's why they're able to stay in White Name in operation, and they're able to continue moving on and not going down the drain, because the people are supporting them.
But it's,
people are supporting
you,
them.
But you gotta, you always get that, Jeffrey, because I'll tell you this. You see St. Maarten? St. Maarten has a capacity of population that is unregistered. We don't even have an idea of all of the people that are unregistered. And when you move around, you see the cars that are on the road, and you see the groceries that are out there, and you see all of them being filled to capacity by the inhabitants of these neighborhoods, buying their food stuff and what have you. But that's not, you know, it's all good for business and all of that. But that's not what the problem is. But the problem is still that we are allowing a lawless community where you have, and in this case, you cannot blame the grocery stores, because there is no legislation in place. And I want to say legislation from the level of parliament. Because you see the problem with when you come with policies. Policies are on the level of the Council of Ministers. And you get a minister coming in after another minister. And what they do, they can change the policy whenever they want to. So, you know, it's like you heard the other day that the moratorium on I think on bus licenses, or I think it's bus licenses and or taxi permits. And so there is a moratorium, yes, and the minister says there's a moratorium, but they're evaluating and they're making and they're trying to see how many of these approved bus permits are in operation. So basically what they're saying, what the minister is trying to say, is that he has not lifted the moratorium. So he's saying if the moratorium is saying that the moratorium is at, let's say, 100 buses, He's not lifting the moratorium, but he is investigating within the 100 buses how many of those buses are operating.
Mm-hmm.
So, in other words, what he is basically saying is that if after the evaluation and the investigation, Jeffrey, he finds 30 buses not in operation, it gives him then, he puts him in the position to then disqualify those buses that have been issued, or let's say that are not in operation, then
he can give 30 more.
Pull them back in and give out 30 new bus licenses that will then keep the moratorium at 100 buses. Basically, that's what the minister is saying, and it's really a wise way of going about it. So it means then that those of you out there who are holding on to bus permits or taxi permits and they are not operating, let's say for years no one is picking up a license plate number or paying whatever taxes for those bus or taxis, and they have been investigated by the government ministries and proven to be a fact, it means then that the government, in this case the minister and his ministry, will then withdraw these permits and make them become available so that he or she is able to issue new permits, but keeping the moratorium at the level that I just mentioned. In this case, I'm saying 100 buses or taxis. He's not tampering with exceeding the 100. He's just eliminating those that are not in operation, which is very wise, because it's not fair for you to be holding on to permits that you are not using while there are so many requests for those people out there who wants to, if they cannot get if they're unemployed and they cannot get a job anywhere and they want to get a permit so they can be their own entrepreneur, that they can do that. Is that a wise way, a wise approach? I can say, of course it is. So if you are not using, whether it's a bus permit or a taxi permit or a car rental license permit or whatever, and it is proven that you are not, then it behooves then the government of St. Maarten to withdraw those permits and then issue them to those who are prepared to operate these bus and taxi permits, Jeffrey.
You know something that I saw? I was at a particular lady's home.
And why are you doing that? I want you to see the comments of those out there, Jeffrey. Why
no, there's no comments, but there are persons like Sualiga Canine, Quincy Rochester, Juliet Gibbs, Jamal Cummins.
Yes.
All persons that are regularly on this program.
Of course.
And what I was trying to say, Roberto, is I was talking to this lady. But this lady is in her 70s. And she has a permit, a taxi permit. But she's not driving the taxi anymore. So there you have a situation where she's not driving. She has a taxi permit.
You're talking about a senior, yes.
A senior.
Yes.
Because there's a lot of seniors that are not driving anymore. There's some of them that give their permit to persons.
Like a help driver.
A help driver.
Yes.
I know of those persons. But I know there's some of them that don't give it to nobody, and they keep the permit for themselves.
You see, that doesn't make any sense. That doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't make any sense, but that's the way this person did it. They don't want to give it to nobody, and they're keeping the taxi permit for themselves. You know, so
you see,
that is something that could be looked into.
That is, those are areas, you know, and while we're talking about that too, Jeffrey, we're also talking about ways in which the government can acquire revenues at this point in time, creative ways, but not also affecting the people of St. Maarten. Because we have to also be creative and also be realistic as to how we're going to approach this, because we can, let's say, we're cutting off the hand of one, we're cutting off the leg of another. So we have to be very careful. We have to use wisdom. And we have to also approach every situation on a case-by-case basis. And why I say that is because every situation can be very much different. And so in this small community, with all that is happening right now economically, we need to go on a case-by-case basis that we don't find ourselves hurting the wrong people, hurting our own people economically, which we do not want to do. You know, it's just like talking about that, Jeffrey, I heard of situations where, and I don't want to really get into details on that, where at this particular point in time, government is legislating or controlling areas that just does not make sense at this point in time, going into a new. I'm just using the example of the things in their decisions that are taken by a government that you would call demissionaire, or not demissionaire, but a government that is, let's say, in its last few months of governing, because we know there are parliamentary elections coming up, let's say in the next 6 months or what have you. So it is the responsible thing to do as a sitting government is not to take serious decisions that can have adverse effect to an incoming government. And things like that also needs to be looked into, because it keeps on happening and it keeps on bringing a new government into office, having to do damage control or not being able to reverse something that has already happened. And it also affects the continued development of St. Maarten, Jeffrey. I want to get your input on that.
No, I want to say something about cars that, I can't remember the name of what we call them, but they are vehicles.
The gypsies.
The gypsies is very important, you know. When I was in France, I remembered, together with a girlfriend of mine then, we called, I can't remember the name of the company then, but it's a company that they put together that can only go to certain areas.
Yes.
And you would call them and they would come directly to whether it's a hotel or whatever, and they would drop you directly to where you're going to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I can't remember the name of it.
Uber?
Uber?
I know something like that, but I know, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, but those
Uber.
And those Ubers, you call them and they will drop you directly to where you're going. So Martin should look into something like that, because those Ubers, they pay taxes as well. So that's where you make certain monies. Government makes certain monies from those Ubers as well. But they can't go certain areas that the buses or the taxis are going. And that is something I think St. Maarten should look into.
So what you're basically saying there, Jeffrey, and we, you know, I've worked with one of the past commissioners in transportation, so I understand what it's all about. Because, again, while there is a surplus in some areas in terms of the economic drive of St. Maarten, we talk about public transportation, we talk about this, we talk about that, there are other categories that are underutilized. Their district in St. Maarten that you can't get. Where I reside in Point Blanche, for example, you can't get a bus out of Point Blanche, because no buses are going to run in Point Blanche. But if you have it categorized, Guanabe as well. But again, if you can categorize those areas some way and structure that, you would be able to issue permits, special permits. It doesn't have to be taxi permit, but special permits where people in those areas are still able to, you know, utilize public transportation in those areas. Or you could also have established some sort of a rotation with the existing buses, where some of them would be obliged, or let's say by law, have to go into these neighborhoods. Let's say on a weekly basis, you know, bus 7 and bus 15 and bus 25 and bus that has to go into these districts mandated by government so that you would get transportation in those areas. So things like that. I wrote something today on Facebook, and I was talking about basically St. Maarten problems. I don't know if you read it, Jeffrey, what I wrote on Facebook, but I was saying that while we are focusing on the big things, a lot of the little problems that we are not focusing on, that we are not addressing, will deal, will work out, will solve the big problems. A lot of little problems we see with the roads, we see the sidewalks, we see, let's say, we see potholes accumulating, we see whatever you want to mention, but the little things that keep accumulating are the problems that has St. Maarten and its development stifled. And you know, and you know, like we talk about over the hill, and we talk about over the hill and above the hill, and we talk about down Simpson Bay area and Cooper Coy area, and we see what's going on down there, and we see what's going on in the Phillipsburg area, and everybody can see what needs to be done. And there is where we need to put a focus in terms of economic development. But because I keep saying it, and we say we on our platform, we keep saying it, that without economic development and without the growth of economic development, Jeffrey, all of these other areas of St. Maarten's development will stagnate. And we know all of these areas, needless to mention them, but if we do not get the development, the economic development of St. Maarten growing and growing as it has been growing over the last 30, 40 years, because everybody, and I keep always keep saying this all the time, everybody sees and enjoys the St. Maarten we have today. Whether you have your complaints or not, nobody wants to leave St. Maarten. Everybody wants to stay here. So it still means that something good is happening. Because St. Maarten didn't just drop out of the sky. So let us look at the good things. And a lot of these good things about St. Maarten didn't happen today. It didn't happen 10 years ago. It didn't happen 15 years ago, 20 years ago. It happened 30 and 40 and 45 years ago. So what happened then that worked then, that kept on working then to now, that we need to probably, let's say, restructure, or we need to improve? And those are things that our team are sitting down, we're looking at. And so there's a group of people, smart people in St. Maarten, who understand what is going on, people who love St. Maarten, people who are experienced, people who have the background, that are looking into all of this and are working into this. And it's all going to be represented in an election campaign that is forthcoming, in our parliamentary election in the next 5 to 6 months, where you, the people of St. Maarten, will get an indication as to what political party, in this case, I didn't want to get into politics, but I'm going to just say it, and the political party that is going to bring you the platform for economic development in all aspects of development, though, and who has a vision for St. Maarten, not just a vision for St. Maarten, but also a vision that is tied to the realities of St. Maarten, because we also have to look at the realities of St. Maarten, and not just, because everybody's going to come with a nice platform, they're going to come with nice ideas, but the idea is, what are the realities, what is really going to work for St. Maarten, and that is the approach that we need to take the economic development from, and tie it to all the other areas that we have been touching on all these last months.
You know, Roberto, I want to mention again, I said it on a platform a couple months ago, and I'm going to repeat it again, because I remember 2011 when I took you to Santo Domingo when you got ill. We went in the airport, and while going through the airport, they told us, you're going to have to pay $10 extra as a visitor coming to St. Martin, to Santo Domingo. So I said, wow. And I said to myself, that's a good idea that any country can use, because since that particular person, or that person that is coming to your country, is going to be coming to enjoy your country, why not charge them a particular fee for coming there and for enjoying it? So I said, one of the things that St. Maarten can do as a country is, whoever comes into our country, whether it's through on an airline or through the port, you charge them a fee. I'm not saying it has to be $10. It could be $5. Whatever it could be. Somebody just told me in one of those ships, it's about 6,000 people is on one of those ships. Yes,
that's right.
And 20,000 people are a part of the crew that operates the ship. So let's say the chef and all those person that is dealing with the boat or the ship.
Running of the cruise ship.
The running of the cruise ship, they are 20,000 people. And 2,000 yeah. people.
I see the point you want to go.
On the ship, you know. So if we look at all of those persons, hey, we can charge them, whether it's $5, $2, $3, wherever it be, we're able to make enough funds to be able to put it into the coffers of this country.
It's a very simple matter, Jeffrey. It is something that is not new to the ears of everybody, because people say, yeah, but just get it done. Every government comes into office, you go into office, you campaign on it. When you go into office, you allow things to go the same way. You just said there, you mentioned the cruise ship business. Let's say if you want to say that there are 2 million cruise ship passengers coming into St. Martin, and you want to say 2 million people giving, let's say, a sort of a whatever fee they have to pay, and they don't, the visitors do not care. 2 million times 10 is $20 million, for example, 40 million guilders. And if you have for overhead passengers coming at Juliana Airport, the same thing, you do the math and you will be able to see the numbers coming up. The Minister of Finance will be able to see revenues coming in without affecting the people of St. Martin. Because one of the things that we have to be very careful as government, is that we do not continue to stress the people of St. Martin. The people of St. Martin aren't going anywhere. We are stressing them with taxes. We are stressing them with whatever. We are stressing them out. We are stressing them because we have people working in various departments, and they just do not understand the importance and the value of keeping the people of the country strong. Keeping your people strong, keeping your people in such a way that they're not, let's say they're able to survive in their country. So not putting this, not stressing them in additional taxes, not wanting to, if you're looking to create more revenues, you're looking at the local people, the small man. That's not correct. There are so many areas that you can, I'll use an example. Let's say if we're going to talk about, this is very creative. Let's talk about domain lands. Domain lands. There are so, because we want to get off of domain lands, which is government lands, belong to the St. Martin people. That is where you need to have the focus on domain lands. I agree that you can also have domain lands also issued to investments, for investment purposes, for the development, the economic development of the country that will create jobs, etc., etc. But you cannot have a situation where there are domain lands that are given off for 10 cents a square meter or 50 cents a square meter, and people are making millions of dollars in development in those areas that with land belonging to the government, while the small man here and there are now in an increased canon category where they are paying a guilder or 2 guilders per square meter. That doesn't make any sense, because what's happening is that sometimes you get a local person having a government land, but they have their back taxes in canon. And they can't pay it. So what are you going to do? You're going to kill them? You're going to kill your Samoan people? That doesn't make sense. So we have to be creative for another way. I'll tell you this. Government is getting X amount of revenues in EDFA canon, as it's called, EDFA canon, government taxes for long lease. Mm-hmm. But it's a few million guilders per year annually, and it's not increasing. But if you take out of that 100%, there is a small 20% for that are in the hands of big development businesses that are paying, let's say, 5 cents and 10 cents canon, that are subdividing the property and are selling the long lease rights of these properties for millions of dollars to developers, to investors, to build villas or what have you. My way, because all of that is great for development, my solution would be is to just, because it will bring revenues into the coffers for the Minister of Finance. Minister of Finance, I'm speaking to you. What you can do is you can sit with your Minister of Romi, for example. Ask him, those properties that are sitting in the hands and long lease of, let's say, hotel operators, in a villa operator, whoever, and that are paying small canons, why don't we just, not a policy, establish a new law or policy, whatever, and those properties sell them outright to these developers. Because it makes no sense to be sitting on them for a few cents per square meter. Sell them out at the value of today's market. And you'll be surprised to see that you may be able to raise $20, $30, $40 million, let's say almost up to probably 100 million guilders, that you can do two things with in terms of development of the country, in terms of buying new land from St. Maarten owners, that you are able them to give in long lease to the St. Maarten people to build their own home, or even give out to the Housing Development Foundation or whatever, so that they can build new affordable housing for their people. It's very straightforward. And I'll tell you, there, I know the areas where this can be done. And I can tell you that the owners of these long lease would gladly do it, because when they are selling out these properties for millions, they would prefer that these people own them outright, then they still have to be continuously paying a long lease. It's a very simple math. 20% of the 100%, that category will be able to give you a balance in terms of revenues for long lease, that you're able to take the pressure off of the people of St. Maarten, so that you're not pressuring them. You can even give them a write-off and then start them over, like I say in Dutch, up new. You can start them over, or you can even put them in a category where the lease, their canon can be reduced, because the canons that are in place right now are too expensive, are too high for someone that is just building a home. It's incredible that on a stretch of property, all of the property, you got 10 properties, 9 of them are paying 10 cents per square meter, and one property is paying 2 guilders per square meter. That's not fair. That one local person is paying that 2 guilders, and don't tell me because, yeah, they got it now, they have to pay the canon of now. It's just not fair. It's just not right. It is not the way for the government to operate in the best interest of its own people of St. Maarten. Jeffrey, I got a bit carried away in that, but I know you would want to give your input on that as well.
Yeah, I listened to you discussing about Erfpachland, and I too worked with Erfpachland for quite some time in government as well. And I remember back in those days, Curaçao was selling all the Erfpachland. They ended up selling a lot of the Erfpachland. I remember that carefully. And they made a lot of money.
Absolutely.
From selling that Erfpachland.
Yes.
At a given moment, St. Maarten wanted to do it, but was not able to do it then. I can't remember the reason why they was not able to do it, because they didn't want to go into selling the Erfpachland because they feel that after a while, when the money is finished, then there's no land and there's no money.
No.
That is something that they were figuring.
Then you're not properly planning it. What I just said is, when you sell that 20%, because the 80% is still in the hands of local people, that 20%, when you sell that and you, let's say you are able to obtain, let's say, revenue, let's say $50 million or $100 million, you take that money and you go to the private landowners and you buy new property. Government will then purchase property and give those lots, subdivide those lots, and
for local people.
For local people, and get them in long lease so that everybody can get a piece of land. You have a list, hundreds or thousands of people, local people, St. Martin people, wherever they come from, who cannot get land because we are saying we don't have land. So when we sell that 20%, what we can do with that 20% revenues is that we go immediately to those family land, those landowners who have land. They don't have money. They can't develop the land themselves. Government is saying, we will buy 20% or 30% of your acres of property so that we can give land and long lease back to our own St. Martin people. But at the same time, we will be giving you millions of dollars that you yourself as family who haven't private land that you cannot develop because you don't have the money, because it was given to you down in generations, that you yourself will then be able to invest so you can do something for your children and your children's children. It's a very, very simple thing. You can do it on day one, Jeffrey, coming into government. It's not nothing to figure out. It's just a decision to make.
One thing I would like to know, what do you believe or think about the hillside policy? That is something that is extremely important to address, because I remember before the hillside policy was made, when you look at some of the hills, you see there were a lot of properties or houses that were built in the hills.
Yes.
Today, they don't have that much because of the hillside policy. Do you think a hillside policy was a good thing to do? Or is something that we could have done differently?
Look, the hillside, first of all, Jeffrey, I'm glad that you brought it up, because the hillside policy, and I can tell you, I don't need to go into the details of that, because I was in government back in those days, and I know where this hillside policy came from. I know where it came from, what angle it came from. But the way it was implemented was not correct. It was not conducive to the realities of St. Martin. Let me explain you why. But I'm going to bring a few categories that are very important. First of all, look, when we're talking about the hillside policies, we're talking about not developing the hills because we want them to stay beautiful in the nature and all that. And I am a person for the I'm a proponent of the environment, protecting the environment. I'm a proponent of nature and all of that. What I'm also saying, and I want to mention that very clearly here, is that the hillside policy also should be implemented for properties that has a grade, which is a steepness that is unbuildable. So government should not issue property, let's say issue building permits for hillside land that, let's say, has a slope above 30%, for example. Those technocrats, those professionals, they know exactly what I'm talking about. So let's talk about slopes 20, 15%. In that angle, 30 or under is where you should be able to give permits on. And that's one. Another thing, because you've seen where we've having disasters right now in some of our hills where it is being excavated, and you know it's like I don't want to say what it is, but it's just impossible that we can allow these things to happen. You can look at some of these projects and you can see before they develop, that's going to be a disaster. If you are a professional in that field, you can see it's going to be a disaster. But what I want to say to, in fairness and also in the interest of the people of St. Martin, is that you have some St. Martin people that have land on the flat, which is no problem. They can develop and they can sell and they can do whatever they want to do with it. But there are some families, Jeffrey, that only own side property, only the hills.
Of course.
So what are you going to do with them? Are you going to say to one property, one family, and you know it, because you and I talk about that.
Of course.
Are you going to say to this family that has never had anything, they let's say they are poor, but they are rich in land, but their land is in the hill, and now they have the hill, and now you're saying that they can't develop the hill. That's not fair to that person who wants to finally do something for their children or their grandchildren. So what do you do? And that is why you have to look at these policies or these laws or whatever you want to call them.
Mm-hmm.
I always call it area specific. You cannot say overall, this is the policy, this is that, because it's not what is going to work here will not work there. And who are you really affecting? You are affecting the people of St. Maarten. What we need to do right now, we need to facilitate the development so that the people of St. Maarten are able to benefit economically in their own country. Not with property alone, but also with businesses that they want to develop in terms of getting licenses and the process it takes to get a business license or what have you, or to get a building permit for their home. They want to get a building permit for their home. It's a routine procedure. I know the procedure. No one has to tell me what it takes, and no one has to explain me if someone brings a drawing for a house, whether it's one or two floors, structurally what it requires. And I am saying that those projects, those properties, those building permits can be approved within a month or less. Because it is very standardized. You go all over, you can see it. Why should the people of St. Maarten or even the investor of St. Maarten has to suffer because of a long, tedious process that is not necessary? It is really not necessary. And because if we want St. Maarten to prosper economically, we need to give the service as government. We need to facilitate in all areas. And that is why St. Maarten has been able to develop. You see, again, you see some people developing and some can't. It's because, let's say, they have the right connections. I don't want to say it in that way. If I know Jeffrey can help me to get things faster. But if I don't know him, I have to stay in a long line. And those are the realities of St. Maarten that is unfair. Point in case is that it needs to be a fair playing field across the board for everyone, because the people of St. Maarten are suffering in all these areas because government is not facilitating, government is not serving, government is not cooperating, government with its lack of love for their own people accommodating, and you know it, we know it, accommodating foreign investors while their own people are suffering. And what kind of government are you when you allow it to happen? Of course, you can have the investments. We need investments. But at the same time, while you are facilitating the investors, facilitate and service your own people, Jeffrey.
Mm-hmm. That's a fact. That is what I wanted to hear.
And the point is, and I'm going to say that, Jeff, you don't have to bring the camera back on me, and I'm going to say it, it's not, you can talk it the talk. You can talk the talk, but when you get there and you're in office, you have to walk the walk. Prove that you can do it. Don't say that you can do it, and don't say that you need another term to do it, because when you're in there, I know the power and the influence of being in government. I know it. I never ran before, but I know it. You can facilitate your people. That is if you want to. That is if you care about them. That is if you love your own people. What does it do to you? What does it take from you to take care of your own people? And that is the problem that we have in St. Maarten right now. And I'll tell you, and everybody can talk about the past, and they can talk about who didn't do it, because what all that we are complaining and we are blaming others about, we are doing the same thing. Three, four rights cannot make a right, and that's the problem, because those who are saying that they are going to be the change are just those who are doing things that are probably maybe 10 times worse than the change that they promised to bring. And those are facts. Those are the facts. And you know, Jeffrey, and it is a very sad thing. And you know, and for me, the only reason I'm running, because I understand, because of sitting in office with persons that are, have had the power with the pen, I know what is possible and know what is not possible. I know. So it, you have to be, it also, you have to be able to be someone that being, when elected to government, parliament, or after appointed to the council of ministers, you have to be able to hit the ground running. St. Maarten is no longer an experiment for politicians who do not understand and know what they're doing. Because while you are experimenting on St. Maarten, the people of St. Maarten in all areas are suffering. It's not you doing your own personal private business. It is the people's business that you're doing. And you are affecting that in a way that is affecting the economic development of St. Maarten. And we cannot afford for that to continue for our next government term. And that is why we who say we can be the difference, we need to prove that we can be the difference, especially if we are the first time. And we who say we are the difference have to prove right now that we can be that difference. Don't say that we can. It is crazy to hear people who are in office or their party is in office and they are saying, when I get in office, I'm going to be the difference. But your political party is in office. So it means that there's a problem in terms of cohesion, in terms of cooperation with you and the people that you are a part of. And that affects the people. That affects the growth. That affects the development of St. Maarten. And we can't have that. We cannot have governments that have their own in-house fighting, running the country, because the people of St. Maarten are going to be the ones that are suffering. And that we say, the dupe. We cannot have the people of St. Maarten being the dupe. So, if you cannot manage your house, you need to step aside and allow people who can manage the house of St. Maarten to govern and to rule for the future. Because the future of St. Maarten depends on it. Jeffrey, I think we're out of time. So, yeah. We got to shut down. You know, I'm sorry if I became
now
very...
You think we are out of
we
time.
We are definitely out of time. What has been the responses out there? And then, because I'm going to shut down. What have been the responses? And then I'm going to allow you to just close us off.
Well, we have Asha Idnani, Jacqueline Burton, Ava Jacqueline said goodnight, family. Beverly Jonas said well said. Beverly Jonas is one of our
supporters,
regular,
oh, yeah.
Viewers. We want to thank all of you. We have reached to the end of our Interact live stream. We hope that you have enjoyed this evening and that you have gotten a lot of what we said this evening. And we hope to see you on Saturday at 1 o'clock again for another Interact live stream program. And we thank you once more for viewing. And God bless all of you. Again, to all of those who have lost loved ones, we want to say to you, our prayers are with you. And we will continue to keep you in our prayers. And we want to thank you once more. Have a good evening, and may God bless you. Bye-bye.